Good morning, sorry I had technical difficulties. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name. Jesus, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You know all things, Father. Good morning, Cousin Keza. Good morning, Fire Rose. Good morning, Mudo. Good morning, Andromeda, Chantel, Letitia. Good morning. Praise and glory to God. Good morning, the Crawfords, Scott and Gina, Pastor Catalina, Sarah. Good morning, everybody. Be exalted now in the heavens. Let your glory fill this place, Lord. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. So, Father God, right now in the mighty name of Jesus, we give you glory, we give you honor, we give you praise right now, Father. Lord, you know everything that is happening in our lives, Father. You know every detail. So, Father, we know that you are sovereign above all things. We may not understand what is happening. We may not even like what is happening. But Father, even through that wilderness, even through that crushing, even through that refining, we recognize that you are always good. You are always good. Lord, your ways are so much higher. Your thoughts are so much higher. Therefore, we surrender our thoughts. We surrender our ways. We surrender our understanding. And lean not on that understanding, and we submit to you, God, in all of your ways, and you make our path straight. Lord, I thank you for your love. I thank you for your presence. Thank you for your word today as we dig into Acts chapter 13. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, 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 amen. Praise and glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. God bless you all, family. Hallelujah. Yes, Andromeda, I like how you just randomly put scriptures in the chat. Amen. Praise God. Let us read. I pray you all are well. God is moving. God is moving. He is removing. And he is moving. God is removing and he is moving. Where God is about to take you, when you are elevated, not everyone can go with you. When God elevates you, not everyone can go with you. Because yes, the heart is deceitful above all things. And we walk by faith and not by sight. Thank you, Jesus. So we thank him for what he does in our lives. We'd never ever understand. There's a lot of change. There's a lot of transition. There's a lot of growth happening in my own ministry. And a lot of it I don't understand, but I surrender to him absolutely, completely. Noah, when he was asked to build the ark, he didn't actually know what the end product was going to look like. He didn't know what that ship was going to look like, let alone what its purpose was. When God asks you to build something, be obedient with the very first step. Take that first step by faith, not by sight. He will give you the dimensions, he will give you the measures, he will give you the instructions, even to the very little detail, in order for you to build. We don't understand why we build things. Only God knows this. But when you hear the voice of your shepherd, because his sheep know his voice, we stay in him, we remain in him, in the spirit, but also we must be grounded in the word. If you are building purely just by the Holy Spirit, you need to think, okay, I need to ground myself in the word as well, because everything comes off the back of the word. Everything comes off the back of the word. Oh, Nikita, you make me cry. You must be grounded in the word. Yes, you can be filled with Holy Spirit fire. Yes, you can be zealous. You can walk in power. You can walk in signs and wonders. But you don't want to get lost in that. You don't want to get too lost in the whole, what can I say? You don't want to get lost in the power of God and what he's doing. You want to remain still and be still. Be still and know that he is God. Be still and remain in him. Hallelujah. Because it's his word that got you there in the first place. It's his word. It's Jesus that elevated you in the first place. So let us not remove ourselves from the one. Let us not remove ourselves from him. Let us not remove ourselves from being so busy that you forget your time with Jesus, that you forget your time meditating on the word and spending time alone with Christ himself, time alone with him. Because it's that, when you understand and you know who Jesus is, when you know who he is, when you love him, when you grow in love for him and with him and around him, it opens up doors for you that nothing else can open. It is the love of Jesus. It is the love of Jesus that he has for you, and it's your love for Jesus. Your love for Jesus will take you higher. Your love for Jesus will take you places that others won't be able to attain, that others won't be able to go, that others won't be able to even understand. Because many people want to know, what is it? I want to see the results now. People are impatient. They want results now. They want to know what's happening now. And we surrender to that. And those who want to be a part of whatever move God has in your life, I'm speaking to you personally, then just believe and know that ministry isn't easy. Ministry and walking with Jesus isn't easy. Walking with Jesus is a journey of refining. It's a painful journey. Whoever said it was an easy journey is a liar. It's a painful journey. Yes, Psalm 46:10. Be still and know that I'm God. Because when God speaks, he doesn't speak with a big booming voice. He has a very quiet, very still voice. It's very still, it's very quiet. And that is the best time for you to hear him, is when you are still, when you are quiet. If you're too busy being busy, I just want to encourage you, set aside your time with him. Be still. Know that he is God. He loves you. Amen. That is good. Good morning. Good morning, Baba Amanda. Good morning. Praise God. Let's read the word, hey? I know that God's going to speak to us today. He's going to speak to us powerfully. Verse 1 of Acts chapter 13. I'm just going to have a drink, a cup of tea, because I feel like cup of tea. Hey, when God takes you higher, never change. Never ever change. Be you. There's no one like you. He made you unique. He made you unique. There's only one of you on the earth. There's only one of you on the earth. So God will glorify himself through you, because you are unique. You are fearfully and wonderfully made, because that's how he designed it. Verse 1. Man, my nose is running today. It's the anointing. The anointing makes my nose run. I've asked the Lord to dry up, you know, dry this thing up like he did the Red Sea, but nah, it ain't happening. Through the refining, I'm finding who I am. Yes, amen. Pray for my sinuses, will you? Hallelujah. Okay. Verse 1. Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. 2. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, "Separate me, Barnabas, and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them." 3. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. Robashi Karababa. I'll just read the 2 more verses there. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. Hallelujah. Let's just park there and unpack this a little bit, huh? Okay. So Barnabas and Saul, I forgot where my notes were about Barnabas's name. Sorry, fams. Barnabas's name meaning. Here we go. Thank you, Jesus. So Barnabas means son of consolation. Saul means prayed for. So it was at Antioch, these teachers, certain teachers and prophets, Barnabas, and it's got here, and Simeon, that was called Niger. Okay, Simeon, we actually knew. Morena, Karina, good morning. Simeon, let's just look up the name, meaning of Simeon. We got it from last reading, the name meaning of Simeon, when we read Genesis. But okay, Simeon means to be heard. To be heard. Okay. That was called Niger. Let's find out the name of that. Niger. Name meaning. Ah, okay, which means black, and I'm not going to say the other word. Maybe that's where it derived from. Yeah. Okay. Okay. And Lucius of Cyrene. Let's get up the name Lucius. It's not Luscious, it's Lucius. White, luminous, white. Interesting. Okay. All mankind. Okay, Holy Spirit. Of Cyrene and Menaean, which he had brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. So we see here, they all ministered to the Lord. Isn't that a beautiful thing? You know something? When you minister to people, you are ministering to the Lord. When you minister to people, you are ministering unto the Lord. When you bless the poor, you are blessing the Lord. When you feed the poor, you're feeding the Lord. When you serve in church, you are serving the Lord. Make sense? It says, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted. Wow. So I believe the Holy Spirit's giving us some biblical keys that can unlock for your separating and your separation to take place. Let me say what. As they ministered unto the Lord and fasted. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost said, not your thoughts, not your words. Hey, London. I think that was London. AA. Praise God. That's the only way I can remember you. So they ministered to the Lord and they fasted, and the Holy Ghost said to them, so in order for you to really truly hear from the Holy Ghost, you must minister to God's people. You must minister at the, you know, through serving others, through serving the church, through praying for others. You're ministering to the Lord. You fast. And the Holy Ghost said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. Wow. So it's the Holy Ghost. His timing, he's the one that separates you. Am I making sense? The Holy Ghost. He says, separate me. And he's saying, like, appoint Barnabas and Saul. Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. So when God is being ministered to by you, when God is seeing that you are sacrificing and you are fasting and you are being obedient, he's going to open your ears to hear from him, the Holy Ghost, and the instructions from him, and he will then appoint you. He will then separate you. When you are separated, it means you are set apart. When you are separated, it means you are set apart. You are set apart for the work for which the Holy Spirit has called you to. In order for God to elevate you, you must be ministering unto the Lord. You must minister unto the Lord. You must bless the poor. You must give to the poor. You must minister to Jesus. You must minister to the weak. You must minister to the lost. You must be a disciple of Christ Jesus, so that he, in the perfect timing, might separate you, might set you apart, for increase for the work which he has called you. I feel the anointing right now, and I believe right now in this time, in this season, that God is preparing you. He's positioning you into a new season of fasting and prayer so that you might hear his still, quiet voice, that you might be led by the Holy Spirit, because there are times when we're not led by the Holy Spirit. But Christ in us, the hope of glory, he is wanting to separate you. He wants to set you apart. It means you're not going to be like all the other kids. Some of these things is doing their own thing. It's like that Sesame Street song. Who remembers that? You're set apart. You're not going to look like all the other kids. You're not going to sound like all the other kids. You're going to be the one that's so far apart from everyone else that they will wonder. They'll probably think that you're just a little bit strange. They'll probably think that you're just out of their league. And you know something? You are. Because when God sets you apart, when God raises you up, when he sanctifies you, when he separates you, you're gonna be an outcast. You're not gonna be loved. You're not gonna be well liked. Why? Because when God elevates you, not everyone's gonna like you. Not everyone's gonna love you. Hey, Rabba Shakarabasi. Not everyone's gonna like it when he elevates you either. So you just keep going. You just keep going. Hallelujah. Some of these things does not belong here. It first starts with ministering to the Lord. You are obedient with him, serving him with all of your heart, because he came to serve us. He's like, ah, tick. Well done, good and faithful servant. I think I can trust this one. They're ministering to my poor people. They're ministering to the weak. They're the ones I want to touch in this world. They're the ones I want to leave behind a legacy. Holy Ghost speaks, sets you apart, separates you for the work that he has called you. Now, don't be surprised, family, if the work he's called you to doesn't look like what you thought it was going to look like. You'll be like, huh? I didn't know I was going to be sent to that nation. Because your plans were to go this way. And God's like, hold up, we're going this way. You're like, oh, okay, Lord, I surrender. I'm just going to follow you. Jesus said, follow me. He said, follow me. You follow Jesus? It's full of surprises. It's full of suddenlies. It's a beautiful place to be when you walk by faith and not by sight. Verse 3, look at this. And when they had fasted and prayed, not if, when, and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So notice it was certain prophets and teachers, right? And, you know, it's got here Simeon, it was called Niger, and Lucius of Siren. These names were Simeon, he was heard. Niger also means black, and Lucius means white. So it's like God used all mankind. Let's look at this in the spirit. Let's just break this down. He looked at this and said, well, all mankind needs these two chosen ones to go out into all mankind to touch those of its kind. Did that make sense? Morena, Sharon. Hallelujah. So there was a setting apart, and they fasted, they prayed, and they sent them away. That's why they were called apostles. To be an apostle means that you are sent. An apostle is sent. An apostle is sent to govern. An apostle is sent to establish things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I showed this last week. You've got the fivefold. Can you guys see my hand? Because it goes a bit blurry sometimes. Fivefold ministry. You've got here the apostle. You've got the prophet. You've got the evangelist. You've got the pastor. And then the teacher. Hallelujah. And so the apostle is able to connect to the prophet, the evangelist, the pastor, the teacher. almost most times, most cases, an apostle will function in one or two or three or four of the other functions as well, because God will send them. So the apostle is the big thumbs up, because in order for Christ to do what he needs to do, we all need to be in agreement. Hallelujah. And the prophet points you to God, says, follow him, not me. Follow Jesus. That's the prophet. He guides you and points you to Jesus. The evangelist is the longest finger on your hand, reaches out to the lost. The pastor, the ring finger, is the one representing the bride of Christ, the church, shepherding. The teacher is the little finger. It's the only one you can really truly fit in your ear. Well, you can probably try putting your other fingers in your other ear, but this one here, you're going to get in there. It makes you, they teach you to hear the word. They help you to understand the word, the revelation of the word. But so does the apostle. Does this make sense? I hope this makes sense. You guys with me? So they were appointed by the prophets and the teachers, and then they were sent out. Verse 4, so they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. So let's look at Cyprus' name meaning. So they were heading to Cyprus. Are you guys okay? Is any of this helping? Oops. Thank you, Jesus. Copper. Oh, yeah, that's right. So they were sent to Cyprus. Remember, Cyprus meaning copper. Remember how I talked about how the wire, you are his wire. Copper is, if you look at the electrical wiring that forms the light that is put on when you flick the switch, that's the anointing. That wire allows the electricity current to flow through so that the power of God might be seen through. So they were sent to a place where it was imminent that the power of God was going to fall. Boom, boom, boom. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. So they sailed to Cyprus. When God sent you, when God sends you, he sends you with power. When God sends you, he sends you with power, family. If you get to a place and you have no power, God didn't send you. God didn't send you. You sent yourself. So we wait upon the Lord. We wait for him. Wait upon his instruction. Wait for him to separate us. Wait for him to set us apart. Because when he separates you, he anoints you. He appoints you. To be anointed by the Holy Ghost and then sending means you're appointed. To be sent means you're appointed. It means it's your time. It means it's your season. Who's being encouraged by this? I pray I'm encouraging some people. Sometimes people misunderstand me. Many people will misunderstand you. Not everyone will like you. It's okay. Jesus loves you. Okay. So they departed unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. They went to Coper. Verse 5. And when they were at Salamis, let's look at the meaning of Salamis. Oh, praise the Lord. Salamis. Name meaning. When they were at Salamis, it means, shaken, test, beaten. Hallelujah. Oh, this is good. Holy Spirit, you're so cool. So they were at Salamis. They preached the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews, and they had also John to their minister. So there was a bit of a shaking there in Salamis. There was a bit of a testing there. There was a bit of a beating there as well. When God also sends you, it's not just going to be all skittles and rainbows and unicorns. It's not going to be all presence, power, and glory. When he sends you, there is a shaking that happens. There is a testing that happens. You're going to get beaten. Oh, hallelujah. This is what it's like to be set apart. Now, God knows what's going to take place, because in order for you, when you are sent with power, you are going to be a big threat. You are going to be a threat to the enemy. The devil is going to know your name as well. He's going to know who you are, because you are sent to a territory that is going to shake some things up. You're sent to a place that's going to beat some people up. You're going to send to a place that's actually going to test a lot of people, not just those whom you are being sent to, but yourself. I can testify to this. Thank God what he did, the revival that's taken place in the Philippines, which remains. Thank you, Jesus. However, I myself have been shaken. I myself have been tested. I myself have been beaten, and it's still with me right now. In fact, the backlash of such revival, the backlash, the aftermath is what I could say, is a shaking. It's a testing to see. It's like a sifting. Not everyone's gonna remain. And praise the Lord. But also there's a part of you that continually needs to die. I'm not there yet. I am far from perfect, but Jesus Christ, he is perfect. Hallelujah. He's the one who's perfect in me. He's the one who's perfect in you. So thank you, Jesus, that even when he sends you and even when he uses you powerfully, you still are gonna go through some shaking. You still are going to go through some tests of your own heart. You still are going to get beaten left, right, forward, behind, front and center. You are going to suffer. Yes, there is a grace for suffering when you are sent. There is a grace for suffering when you are sent. Hallelujah. You guys okay? So you continue preaching the word no matter what. You just keep focused. You keep building that ship. You keep building what God has told you to build. And don't look to the left or to the right. Hallelujah. Verse 6. And when they had gone through the isle unto Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer, a false prophet, a Jew, whose name was Bar-Jesus. I'll just read this up to about 13, and I'll unpack from 6 to 13. Verse 7, which was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus, a prudent man who called for Barnabas and Saul and desired to hear the word of God. 8, but Elymas the sorcerer, for so is his name by interpretation, withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith. 9, then Saul, who was also called Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, set his eyes on him. The eyes. 10, and said, O full of all subtlety and all mischief, thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? 11, and now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season. And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand. 12. Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed, being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. 13. Now when Paul and his company loosed from Paphos, they came to Perga and Pamphylia, and John, departing from them, returned to Jerusalem. So there's a bit of controversy that we have here with Bar-Jesus. Hang on, sorry, I'm getting cold. I'm just going to put something on. Sorry, guys. I want to be comfortable. Okay. So, a bit of controversy with Bar Jesus, and the first thing that I see is his name. His name, he was a false prophet. When I see Bar Jesus, I see Bar like a dash, Jesus. He was a false prophet because he had no Jesus. Holy Spirit. There was no Jesus in him. False prophets don't know Jesus. They're far from him. Hallelujah. That's what I see here. So he was a certain, they'd gone through the aisle unto Paphos. They found a certain sorcerer, false prophet, a Jew, whose name was Bar Jesus. 7, which was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus, a prudent man who called for Barnabas and Saul and desired to hear the word of God. So praise God. This guy by Jesus, minus Jesus, he attached himself to the governor, Sergius Paulus. He was the intelligent man. The governor invited Barnabas and Saul to visit him, for he wanted to hear the word of God. Again, because you're set apart by the Holy Spirit, you're going to increase in stature. Big people will invite you. Big names will invite you. Invitations will come. Praise God. Not just from pastors or synagogues and churches, but also the other spheres of influence, across the business mountain, across the governmental mountain, education, family, entertainment, hallelujah. So they were set apart and people knew them, so they invited them to come. So verse 8, but Elymas the sorcerer, for so is his name by interpretation, Rabba Shikarabababababa. Ah, okay, so let's look at Bar Jesus. Name meaning, it will probably say Elymas. It says son of Joshua. Withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith. Right, that was his name in Greek. So the governor had sent and invited Barnabas and Saul, but there were people around them that urged them not to pay attention to them. Again, this is part of the shaking. This is part of the testing. This is part of the spiritual warfare that you will face when you've been sent. Don't ever think it's all glory. Don't ever think it's all very easy. There are a lot of battles that one faces that many cannot see. Many don't see a lot of the battles. They see the glory, they see the glamour, they see the power. But on a daily basis, you're having to experience these kinds of attacks. They come hard, they come fast, but you have to still continue serving God's people no matter what, no matter what. So this Elymas, the sorcerer, remember sorcery is a form of witchcraft. Sorcery is a form of witchcraft where they use objects and things like that to try and receive some form of power. It's a false source of powers. It's a false source. It's like self-righteousness. It's false. It's divination. It's a form of witchcraft. So when you're bound by witchcraft, you are disaligned from the Spirit of God, because it taints your understanding. It will have you think that Anyone who's in and of God is actually against you and is actually attacking you. You will feel and believe that everyone is out to get you, which it's not true. I've witnessed people who have been bound by witchcraft who absolutely think that I'm out to destroy them. And I'm not. Because their perception, they are bound. They need to be set free from their bondage. So we can see that was happening here with Elymas the sorcerer. He did everything he can. He didn't want the governor to hear the word or what the word that was being preached. They didn't want him to hear the truth. The devil roams around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. But listen to this. When God sends you, he is with you, he is for you, and the enemy is being used for your benefit. Why? So that you might be tested, so that you might be shaken. Because there's a lot of, I guess you could say, infirmities, or you could say impurities that are still inside of you that need to go. So we thank God for that. We thank God for the spiritual warfare. Never ever think of it as a bad thing. Think of it as an opportunity to grow. Spiritual warfare is an opportunity for you to grow. The attacks of the enemy that God has allowed. Let me say this. Every time you're attacked by the enemy, God has allowed it. Ask him why. Ask yourself, why is this happening? And almost always, it's so that you can become more like him. We can get too comfortable otherwise. You can get very comfortable in the goodness of God, which is a good thing. However, when you have a greater calling on your life, you're gonna continually be refined every day. Be prepared to be crushed even more. Every day, be prepared to be pruned. Every day, prepare to be refined. Yes, Job, 100%, he endured so much, but he remained in God. He trusted God despite all of the attacks that were coming. So verse 9 says, then Saul, brackets, who also is called Paul. Remember, Saul means prayed for. Paul means humbled. So not only had he been prayed for, he was also a man who humbled himself. God spoke to me this morning about humbling yourself. The Bible says, humble yourself. It's not, humility is not something that we ask God to do. It's something that we must do and obey. Humble yourself. That means you do it. It's not a matter of prayer. It's a matter of obedience. It's a matter of a decision, saying yes to God's word. Remember, the word of God will show you the answers. Why are you praying for things that are already in his word? It's done, it's said, it's written, it's finished. Finito, he said, it is finished. Trust me, trust my word, trust my words, hear my voice. You'll never go wrong. Hallelujah. So Saul, who is also called Paul, prayed for and humbled, filled with the Holy Ghost, set his eyes on him. When you're filled with the anointing and the Holy Ghost, you will see and know and be able to discern, because the power of the Holy Ghost will have you pay attention to certain individuals. It's like all your alarm bells go off. Red flags, red flags, red flags. I get that often. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And in Philippines, I was able to understand and know, okay, these people here need deliverance. It was highlighted. I could see who it was. I could see who I could minister to. And in fact, God was doing the whole thing. Right, I just put in my 2 cents worth. So he said, verse 10, And he says, and said, "O full of all subtlety and all mischief, thou child of the devil." He was the son of the devil. So you have God's children, God has children, but there are also devil's children. It's written a few times in the Bible that there are some who are actually sent by the devil as the devil's children. Said, "Thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all righteousness." So the enemy of Jesus. Jesus is our righteousness. He is full of deceit and fraud. "Wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of God?" Will you never stop perverting the true ways of the Lord? He was rebuked. He spoke the truth. He spoke the truth. He said it. This is how it is. This is what is happening. This is who you are. Will you not cease and stop perverting the true ways of the Lord? That's boldness. That's courage. Verse 11, "And now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season. And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand." Family, get your hearts right. If you are walking in any form of deceit or any form of anything that's not of the Lord, it's a warning, because when the power of God comes, when the Holy Spirit comes, he will close your eyes. There will be a curse that will come upon you. Verse 11 is literally a punishment to being disobedient and walking against and coming against God's anointed. The Bible says, "Touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm." You are perverting the ways of God if you are it could happen. A very simple example could be gossip. Maybe offenses come into your heart about a certain person. You start sharing that offense with others, which is gossip. It's a form of witchcraft. It causes deceit in the hearts of other people. And so what happens is you're actually coming against God, not the actual person. It means that there's a part in your heart that's been submitted to not God, but to the devil. So we must watch ourselves. We must watch our thoughts and our words. Holy Spirit will say, don't do that. Don't say this. Don't say that. What's going on here? If you're truly listening to him, he will convict you of your motives. He will convict you of your emotions. He will convict you of your deceit. We're all human. We all go through it, family. None of us are exempt. Not even me. So we must every day purify our hearts before the Lord. Lord, create in me a pure heart. Renew in me a right spirit. If there's any way in me. In fact, you know, I know myself so well, and the Holy Spirit knows me too, because him and I are really close, and I feel the yuckiness, and that yuckiness that I feel is almost showing me that there's a reflection of what is happening around me that is going on inside of me, because everyone is made in God's image, and then we can all sometimes even reflect facets of his image. But I always take anything that happens as a sign of, yes, the persecution, a sign of opposition, yes, but I always look at myself. Papa, what are you saying to me? What is this devil's child? Why are they placed in my life right now? Right, yes, we rebuke them in that, but I always seize the opportunity to take a look in the mirror, in the spiritual mirror, and ask the Lord, where am I at? Where am I at, God? Is my heart still pure? Am I still surrendering? Am I still hearing your voice? You know what I mean? But he was rebuked. A curse came upon him. God can also bring a curse upon a person. People think it's the devil. Well, look at this. Verse 11 says, this is literally punishment. He was struck blind. You will not see sunlight for some time. Whoa. Verse 12, then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed, been astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. Isn't it interesting how this sorcerer was trying to stop him from speaking and preaching the word to the governor? And so in the witnessing of what is taking place, Paul rebuked him. He told him how it was. He told him what was happening in his heart. He rebuked him, and basically the curse came on him. He was blinded. He couldn't see light. And it's interesting because the deputy, the governor, saw. He was watching. He saw what was taking place. He became a believer because he witnessed, because the power, the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. It means it's not in mere or talk. It's in the power of God. He witnessed. So even the word can be preached through those who come against you. Does this make sense? You are a living word. The word is alive. The word is active. The word is quick. The word is powerful. It is sharper than any double-edged sword. So as Paul was walking in the power of the Holy Spirit and his eyes were fixed on this sorcerer, he then rebuked him. He called it out. He spoke the truth. The truth will set you free, but it will also bring that punishment upon those who are against the will of God, who are against the plan of God. And never ever worry, when God sends you, he will send you spiritual and heavenly backing. You are protected by the Holy Ghost. You are protected by the heavens. Praise God, by God himself. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He believed. He saw what was done and he believed. Some people need to see a miracle. Some people need to see revival. Some people need to see the power of God falling upon a certain atmosphere in order for them to believe. It's happened. It's happened recently with the Philippines. People saw the glory of God. People saw what was taking place in a whole other different country, and it changed their hearts. They repented. They came before God. Why? It made them believe that God really is alive, because he is. He is so alive. He is so alive. Man, never in my life could I have imagined to witness that right before my very eyes, to witness the goodness of God. You know, even the sound of deliverance, people hate the sound of deliverance because it's all screaming. It's a sound of freedom. It's a sound of freedom. We need to come on, church. No more demon daycares. We need to start doing what Jesus did. Jesus spent so much time during his ministry casting out demons. We've stopped doing that in the church. The majority of the church don't function in the same ministry as Jesus. Hi, te mga. They don't function in the same ministry as Jesus. We need to. Don't be afraid of it. I remember when I started doing deliverance, people used to think, oh, what about the kids? I'm afraid for my kids. I'm like, your kids need to learn this stuff. God loves them more than you do. He's protecting them. And in fact, the Bible says, let the little children come to me. And you know something? Even when children have witnessed deliverance, they will never forget it. Teach them in the ways of God, and they shall not depart from it. They will know. They will know. God loves them. Okay, so never ever fear. Remember, your children are not your children. They are God's children. Surrender. You not only have to surrender your life, but you have to surrender theirs too. Yes, you can be protective, but don't be so protective that you control. You control what happens in their life. Don't manipulate what happens in your children's lives. Remember, if you are truly surrendered, you will just thank God. Okay, kids, this is how it is in the kingdom. There are things called demons and they're coming out. Then they will know. Yep, deliverance is the sound of freedom, the evidence of the presence of the Lord. Yes, because deliverance is a sign that there's no presence of God in your life. Deliverance is a sign that there is no presence of God in your life. You need the presence of God. It's not about demons. No, I'm making it all about Jesus because he's the one who set us free. So let's glorify him. Let's stop talking about demons. Let's just talk about the glory of God, the power of God, and what he is doing and how those things have to submit. Every knee must bow. Every demon must bow in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Praise and glory to God. God bless you all. Is this helping anyone? If so, hit me with a coconut or a fire emoji. Whoo, verse 13. Man, how big is this chapter? Ay, 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 ay. Sorry, guys, I'm going to have to do a part two, eh? Yeah, because it's way too long. Okay. Okay. All right. Ay, 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 ay. Rabashikaramase. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Verse 13, now when Paul and his company loosed from Paphos, they came to Perga and Pamphylia, and John, departing from them, returned to Jerusalem. So there was controversy with Bar Jesus in verse 6 to 13. The governor, the deputy, he invited him because he wanted to hear the word of God. Not only did he hear the word of God, he witnessed the power of God. Hallelujah. Changed, and then he believed. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So then Paul, he preaches on the first Sabbath. I think I'm only going to go... I'm just going to do a few more verses and then we're going to finish there. And I'll do part two tomorrow. Paul preaches on the first Sabbath. 14, but when they departed from Perga, they came to Antioch in Pisidia and went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and sat down. 15, and after the reading of the law and the prophets of the rulers of the synagogue sent unto them, saying, ye men and brethren, if ye have any word of exhortation for the people, say on. So it's prophetic time. Okay, prophetic ministry time. Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost. Remember, his name is humbled. Used to be Saul, prayed for. He's like, okay, I'm going to get up. So he got up, stood up, verse 16, and beckoning with his hand, said, men of Israel, and ye that fear God. Give audience. Oh, so he went in there like gangster mode. Paul stood up, lifted his hand to quiet them. Man, check that out. Whew. He stood up, lifted up his hand. Everyone went quiet. It's true. It works. He said, and you God-fearing Gentiles, listen to me. 17, the God of this people of Israel chose our fathers and exalted the people when they dwelt as strangers in the land of Egypt, and with an high arm brought he them out of it. He's reminding them of how God chose the nation, how God chose the ancestors and made them multiply and grow strong during their stay in Egypt. Hallelujah. Then with a powerful arm, he led them out of their slavery. So he was almost restoring the power and the move of God, reminding them, we can easily forget. We can easily forget what God has done powerfully in our lives. Let us not forget, family. Verse 18, and about the time of 40 years, suffered he their manners in the wilderness. So God put up with them for 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. We know where Paul's going with this, don't we? Hallelujah. 19, and when he had destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan, he divided their land to them by lot. He wasn't holding back. He was just like, boom, boom, shk, boom, shk, boom, shk, boom. Oh, he gangster. Then he destroyed seven nations in Canaan and gave their land to Israel as an inheritance. Verse 20, and after that he gave unto them judges about the space of 450 years until Samuel the prophet. So all this took about 450 years. Wow. After that, God gave them judges to rule until the time of Samuel the prophet. Verse 21, and afterward they desired a king, and God gave unto them Saul, the son of Cis, a man of the tribe of Benjamin by the space of 40 years. So he's just reminding them of the history. Yeah, people begged for a king. God gave them Saul, prayed for, son of Kish, a man, the tribe of Benjamin, who reigned for 40 years. He had dominion for 40 years. 40 meaning dominion. 22, watch this. And when he had removed him, right? This is God removing him. When God anoints you and appoints you, there's a time when God says, okay, your time is up. And then he will anoint and appoint someone else. When God sends you, he anoints you, then he appoints you. And there is a season in which you will reign and you will have dominion and God will use you powerfully. But there's also an overlapping where, as an Elijah, you would have many Elishas where they would be anointed and then appointed for the time with which God takes you up. So understand that your role as well isn't just for you. Your role when God uses you is to impart that to others so that the multiplication, remember, God multiplied. God brings multiplication. Paul was sent so that he might impart the grace that he was given, that he might impart new revelation, that he might impart a God-fearing mandate upon the people. He was sent for a greater purpose. There's always a greater purpose, more than what you see in the calling upon your life. Hallelujah. So he removed him. God removed him. Verse 22. And he raised him up unto them, David, to be their king. Hallelujah. Because Saul, he could have humbled himself. Right? He could have become a Paul, but he was always Saul. They prayed for him, but he could have humbled himself and he could have prepared David for the call. Instead, he came against them. He didn't like that David was being used powerfully. He didn't like that David was loved by the people. So God raised David up. God's will be done. To whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. I'm going to park right there, but in adding to that, God removed Saul, replaced him with David. God said, I found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything that I want him to do. He will do all that I have fulfilled through my own will. He is after my own heart, and he shall fulfill all of my will. If man doesn't come into alignment with the will of God, God will humble them. God gives grace to the humble, but he humbles the proud. Either way, the plan of God and the will of God, the purposes of God will never, ever be shaken because he is God. Whether we are obedient or not, God knows if you're going to be obedient. God knows if you're going to be disobedient. He will still use you. There is a purpose in all of this. Again, if we think that we've figured God out, we don't know God. If we think that we're completely understanding of him, look, we only know this much. We only know this much when it comes to God. We only know so much. God knows everything. He sees your heart. He sees your motives. He sees your thoughts. To whom much is given, much is required. Praise God. So we see that this is Paul. I'm actually going to park it right there today. That's what the Holy Spirit's saying. But to leave it on that note is that we are to be a child, a daughter, a son who is after God's own heart. Because when you're after his heart, you fulfill his will. When you love God with all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your soul, when you love your neighbor, when you love your enemies, you are aligned with him, you are aligned with his will. So Father, I pray, Lord, that we would continue to humble ourselves, O God. Not our will, but your will be done in our lives, Father. We thank you, God, that in order for us to be sent, we must be set apart. In order for us to be sent, we must be separated. In order for us to be sent, we must be anointed with power and then appointed with power. Father God, knowing that we will come to a place where we can be shaken and tested and beaten, Father God, but knowing that we will just continue to remain in you, being full of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we also have learned today that there are children of God and that there are children of the devil, and that every attack of the enemy has been ordained by you for a purpose, so that we might refine ourselves in the shaking, in the beating, in the testing. Lord, we also know that we can testify to people needing to hear the word, and they can believe simply by seeing the power of the word. For the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. Lord, I pray that we would understand the authority that we carry, Father, when we are sent. To be sent with power means that you are glorified. Let us not glory in ourselves. Let no man glory in and of himself, Father. Lord, we all desire to be used powerfully. We all do, Father. But let us remain in your word. Let us remain humble. Let us be still and know that you are God, Father. For this is the main thing. We keep the main thing, the main thing. And his name is Jesus. Thank you, Father, for trusting us. Thank you, Father, for allowing us to be used by you. For that is our desire. We want nothing more. Our supreme desire in our hearts is to simply to love you, to worship you, to honor you. And reading of the word is so that we can begin to understand you. Just that little bit more each and every day. We bless you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you, family. I love you all. I'm going to park right there for today. Yes, let us remain being humble. Providence of God to use all for his will to be done. Amen. I stand in agreement. So tomorrow we're going to continue on from verse 23. I'll try to move a bit faster. Yeah, we'll do the rest of 13. Hallelujah. Love you all, family. God bless you. Please subscribe if you haven't already. Please hit the thumbs up if you haven't already. And please do send a link to friends that you know that could really benefit from just hearing the word. You know, faith comes from hearing, and hearing the word of God. When people hear the word of God, you're literally plucking them out of the depths of hell. You're pulling them out. You're pulling them out. You're setting them free. People just need to hear the word. Amen. I love you all. God bless you. I'll see you tomorrow. Oh, sorry. See you on Thursday. Thursday morning. Hallelujah.